I revere this man and worked for him in two elections and in his White House, and I think he did an amazing job and is one of our greatest living Americans. No, I don't think he has a responsibility to speak out. I mean, once he left the presidency, he has basically stayed out of politics. Not everybody in his family has necessarily, but he, as a former president, has made the decision not to engage in the way that other former presidents have, and I think we ought to respect that. Look, he gives speeches and he does public appearances and he makes his views on issues known from time to time, but he has personally chosen not to wade into this personally, and I think we ought to leave him alone about it because it's his right to do that.
It's absolutely his right. You're correct on that. I think, to me, what is more upsetting is and disappointing is the fact that, you know, we were just having a conversation about how low the Republican Party can actually go in North Carolina, lower than many of us ever thought possible. And yet, how about speaking out about the fact that the former president, who is now trying to go back to the White House, actually incited an insurrection and violence at our Capitol where people died? How about the fact that this man has 34 felony counts against him? I mean, you don't have to speak out if it's about, you know, if you don't want to. But if you don't speak out, this is what happens to your party. And I think I agree, actually, with Liz Cheney that maybe you got to just burn it down and try to build something
new.
Did
you ever think that Dick Cheney would be the first right. to endorse a Democrat and not George W. Bush? I don't know. Go ahead.
You know, when I think about, all of us are talking about democracy. Interesting, on both sides, everybody's saying democracy is at stake. I think the question is, what kind of democracy do we want? Do we want one that's bent on vitriol and hate and division? Or do we want one that takes seriously issues like 800 people dying a day from poverty and low wages, 200 and some thousand people a year, that is unnecessary? If that's the case, I don't know of a time when a president puts his hand on the Bible and swears to defend this country from enemies, domestic and abroad, did they ever retract that? So he's still under that oath. We still call him this president, former president. And in that sense, if in fact, I'm not talking about his personal, political and moral responsibility, you see a threat, as he has said, to this country that will keep us from dealing with the real issues that we face, the hard issues we face, yes, there's a moral obligation on every American, and especially those who have led at the highest level. He's never retracted that commitment to defend us from.
I just don't think it matters. I mean, maybe it matters to Republicans, but I mean, I don't really care whether George.
Would you want it as a Democrat? Like you want it?
It's another thing I could use against Scott, you know, in the next debate. Say, hey, you're a guy.
And that's all
guy.
You really want, isn't it?
Yeah, but other than that, you know, no, I mean, right. I don't want any Democrat who's going to change their opinion about Donald Trump because of what George W. Bush says. I don't know that even the Republicans would change their opinion about Donald Trump because of what George W. Bush says, because Donald Trump has taken over the Republican Party. But what we do know is that Donald Trump's own people, his own vice president, his own secretary of state, his own attorney general, his own defense secretary, his own chief of staff, his own national security advisor have all condemned him at several different times. His own niece has called him a racist. His nephew has said he uses the N-word. I mean, Omarosa, his top black aide, said he was a racist. Everybody who knows this guy, who has had a position of influence, has had some sort of negative thing to say about him. So it's not some sort of Democratic conspiracy. The people who know him best say Donald Trump is a horrible person.
At one point, though,
do we start to listen to the actual people we're supposed to be listening to? I mean, the man was elected in 2016, got the most votes of a sitting president in 2020. He won the nomination again, and he is leading in the race for re-election.
I feel like if you list all those things, you also have to note he lost the popular vote in 2016.
Twice.
He lost the election.
That's not how we elect
and the popular vote in 2020. So even in all those cases,
you're saying the people don't want the majority of people have rejected. We do not elect our presidents by popular vote. That's not what you said. What I'm saying is that's how we elect our presidents.
No. And he is the leading candidate right now. And at least in the Republican Party, you can literally tell people, whether it's Washington, D.C., New York, former politicians, the people have said, the heck with you. We want someone who's going to fight for our issues. We were tired of being lied to.
But in a sense, this president didn't fight. He fought against the American people. He fought against those who are hurting.
He raised wages. He did not raise the minimum wage. The things that he did, he inherited an economic situation that was already up from Obama. This man incited an insurrection. He has used the office for meanness. He's used the office for hurt. He's not used it as a president, and we the people. And if you want to listen to him, I agree. We should listen to him. Every lie he's told, we ought to listen to him. Every bad economic thing, we ought to listen to him. Everything he didn't do during the pandemic, we ought to listen to him. He was worse than Woodrow Wilson on the pandemic, who was bad himself and got 600,000 people to die. We should listen to him, but we should, as a people, speak.
Is